All right, we now welcome a very special guest. This Lethbridge, Alberta native was selected 28th overall by your Ottawa Senators in the 2020 NHL Draft following a breakout season with the Brandon Wheat Kings, and now he's back dominating the WHL after a four-game stint with the Belleville Senators. Ridly Greig, welcome to Locked On Senators. How you doing today, man?
Doing pretty good. You guys?
Fantastic. Well, we're kind of stuck inside right now. I know you're in the WHL bubble and playing that 24-game season, just over halfway. The team's doing great. What's been rolling for you guys early here?
Our team kind of right off the start, we kind of clicked pretty good, and I think we had a 8 or 9 game winning streak there, and ever since then, we've just kind of been rolling along every game.
Yeah, no doubt. You big part of that as well, a couple long point streaks back after one game. Just take it off, you know, let the other guys have a chance at some cookies and then right back after it. But we like to start these interviews off by turning the clock way back. Now, you grew up in a hockey family. Your dad played pro in North America and in Europe. He's been a scout in the NHL as well. What are your earliest memories falling in love with the game?
When I was over in Germany with my dad when he was playing there, I think my parents kind of just threw me into hockey right away. And then we came back, and I grew up kind of in Coaldale and then Lethbridge. And I think just having my parents throw me in the game, I think I kind of just fell in love right away playing mini sticks or rollerblading around the house or something like that. But yeah, I just kind of fell in love right away.
Yeah, that's awesome. And now you mentioned that your dad played in Germany, similar to a couple other fathers of players on this team, Drake Batherson's dad, Josh Norris's dad. And as I'm sure you know, third overall selection, Tim Stützle, the German, is speaking with those guys. Now, Drake Batherson and Josh Norris claim to be fluent in German. How is your German language? Could you hold up a full conversation with Timmy or no?
Oh, no chance. I only lived there till I was like 4. So, definitely not. No.
When did you start playing competitive hockey over there? Or I guess not competitive, as you said, you're only 4, but you're already starting to skate over there before coming back.
I was like kind of just messing around on the ice with my dad after games or practices or something. But, I think kind of when he came back, maybe in, Timbits or initiation or something like that, but.
What? Yeah. How old were you? I know the WHL draft's a year earlier than the OHL, so like when you're turning 15, right? What age you thought, man, I could really go somewhere with this?
Yeah, my team kind of, when I was growing up, all my teams have been like pretty good teams. We've won provincials a couple times, and I've always been fortunate to be on a good team. So I kind of guessed like first year, second year Bantam, my draft year there, I kind of figured maybe I could kind of get drafted high or something. And then ever since then, I'm kind of just, you know, doing everything I can to try to make the NHL.
Now, what was it like when you were playing in Alberta and you're playing for Team Alberta? Describe that for us.
Yeah, that was obviously a really fun kind of U16 tournament there. Obviously, Jake Sanderson, too, was there. I think me and him kind of clicked pretty good at that tournament. I think our first goal, he made a nice saucer pass to me in the middle of the ice, and then I scored on a breakaway, I think. But that was obviously a really cool experience. I think that was kind of the start where all the Team Canada and under-17s kind of, that's when you started to get scouted for that stuff and things. So. I think we lost in the finals to an overtime loss, so it kind of sucked at the end, but yeah.
Man, so you're saying that prepared Jake for that 5 overtime loss, man. Imagine, what have you ever been in a long game like that goes 2-3-4 OTs?
No, I haven't. I think maybe second overtime is the longest one, but yeah, that's definitely one of the tougher losses I've seen. That sucks, yeah.
Yeah, but you guys knew each other way back. Like, I was telling Jake this last week, too, and one of the coolest subplots from the NHL draft was the fact that exactly 30 years earlier, both your dad and his dad got selected by the same team. I thought that was amazing. So, what was the relationship like, let's say, between your dads? Because he said his dad fist pumped when they selected you at 28. What was your dad's reaction?
Yeah, I think when my dad saw that Jake went to Ottawa, apparently Jake Sanderson's dad was texting my dad saying Ottawa, 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 and then sure enough, I went to Ottawa, and in the back of my mind, I like obviously I got picked, and it took me probably 10 or 15 minutes till I realized that, holy shit, like Jake Sanderson got drafted there too, and after that, I was like, what are the odds of that? You know, our dad's 30 years ago, and now us, so pretty crazy how it works.
Yeah, definitely a storybook kind of tale there. And you probably had visions of that saucer pass that you had on Team Alberta in your head too. Can't wait to get a couple more of those tape-to-tape passes happening. Now, I want to get into your draft day, because this draft was unlike any other draft we've had before. Lots of different people had different draft day experiences when normally everyone would just go to the arena where the draft is being held. Take us through your draft day experience, Ridly.
So I have quite a bit of family kind of in Lethbridge. So I think we had maybe 15 to 20 kind of family members and friends. And then kind of just sat there and waited, and then obviously got picked. And then we kind of just had a few more people came over after and kind of just had maybe a little gathering. And it was pretty fun. And definitely obviously remember that forever.
Free for all the other hats once you knew you were going to Ottawa?
Yeah, I think a couple of my family members were just grabbing and picking hats. So, yeah.
Got to save the Flyers one for the old man. What was that conversation? You couldn't convince the Philly brass to take you earlier?
Yeah, I guess my dad didn't want to pick me there. But, yeah, I don't know. I got no words for that one, but definitely pretty funny.
No, that's great, man. And then, so usually you get the experience, I'm not saying usually, in typical draft years, I mean, that the players are selected and then they go right off to their cities, have development camp, clearly a different world. But then you had the opportunity, we're going to get into the Team Canada stuff, but afterwards you end up having the chance to come to Ottawa for training camp and you do the quarantine, you ultimately play four games for Belleville. What was that experience like getting to taste of pro hockey? Not many 18-year-olds get to say they played in the AHL.
Yeah, it was obviously, for my development wise and opportunity, it was amazing. It was such a good experience just kind of seeing how pro works and how everybody goes about themselves. And those four games, I think in that whole month that I was there, I think that was probably the most development I've had in a long time. Obviously, just seeing those guys play and then seeing how fast the game was. And it was almost like there were seven guys on the ice, but just to see that kind of makes you want to train harder and work for your goal.
Yeah, and you got to experience four games, which isn't a lot, but you get to get in the groove of things. What were, you mentioned the speed of a lot of the guys, what were some of the biggest adjustments for you to play your style of game going from playing in the WHL to going to a pro level at such a young age?
Yeah, going into it, I knew it was going to be a lot faster. And then I think the thing that I picked up on right away was just how much bigger everybody is and stronger. Winning faceoffs was definitely a lot harder. Going against Wheel, I think it was. But I think that was kind of the one and two things that I kind of took away from that.
And you got to play at the Bell Center as well, which is pretty sweet, against Laval there to start off. And Troy Mann played you right up the lineup. Who were your wingers there for those few games?
Yeah, I was playing with Logan Shaw and Formington there.
Yeah, Formington might be the fastest guy we've ever seen. What's it like skating on the ice with that kid?
Yeah, that was kind of the first thing I picked up on him. He just fly like the wind. Just give him the puck and he'll go wide and kind of burn the D-man. So.
No doubt. We're seeing that translate to the NHL. Do you get to catch a bunch of Senators games? You falling a little closer now?
Yeah, I try to as much as I can. We're pretty busy right now, pretty much playing every other day. But I usually watch the highlights and follow along.
Yeah, I mean, there's been lots to follow along. It's great to have hockey back. And since you played in Belleville, have you kind of kept up with those guys, you know, kept in touch with them as the season's going along? I know you said you're busy and you're fully kind of immersed with the Brandon Wheat Kings now, but are you still in touch with guys from Belleville? And to further that question, have guys from Ottawa been in contact with you as well since you've been drafted?
Yeah, obviously I try to kind of keep in touch with those guys, but I think the one guy for me, Cole Reinhardt, my old teammate there, me and him kind of text back and forth quite a bit, and I'm always checking in to see how he's doing, get a goal or assist or whatever it is. But he's probably the guy I've kept in touch with the most.
Is the story true? We heard a rumor that he was out baling hay when he got drafted, or did he tell you about that?
That is true. Yeah, I think he was on the tractor getting hay or something. He's a big rancher kind of north of Calgary, so that's definitely one of the more funny stories I've heard.
Does he have that farm boy strength? Like, can you tell that he's a farm boy, that he hasn't, you know, he's not on the bench press, but that guy's lifted more bales of hay than anyone else, you know?
Oh yeah, 100%. You can tell right when I see him. Sometimes he'll kick out the cowboy hat and the boots. the big belt he wears quite a bit, but you can definitely tell he's a really big farm boy.
Man, you had another Alberta guy as your coach last year. Now he's on an NHL bench. But what did Dave Lowry do for your development last year? He's a big, tough, defensively minded coach from what we've seen from him.
Yeah, me and Dave, we connected pretty well last year. I think he helped me quite a bit, kind of just finding my role and helped me in the D zone. I think I always remember, like, I'll have a bad shift or a bad first period, and I'd come off to the bench and he'd kind of just give me the look, and I know that I'd kind of have to wake up or get my feet moving or something. But yeah, we had a pretty good connection.
How would you compare or contrast that with Troy Mann's coaching style?
Honestly, they were honestly kind of similar. I definitely liked them both a lot. I think they were pretty much the same kind of style of coach. They held you accountable and kind of connected with the players quite a bit and around the room and stuff. So I definitely liked them a lot. Yeah.
Nice. That's what seemingly comes out from all Belleville press conferences and everything. He just seems like such a character and someone who you can communicate well with. So that's great to hear. He's developed clearly half of Ottawa's roster. Pilsy and I worked in Belleville the last couple of years doing some production, and just the turnover in that team's been crazy. And now you're seeing the dividend. Does that kind of invigorate you as well, seeing kind of the graduation and the situations Ottawa is in right now about bringing in all these young players? It must be exciting to be a part of.
Oh yeah, 100%. Pretty much every time I look at Twitter or whatever, Instagram, I see about how many prospects Ottawa has and the Senators prospects and blah, blah, blah. But definitely just feels amazing kind of be a part of that group, and hopefully we'll kind of have a good team going coming up years here.
Yeah, no question. But before you get to the NHL, I think another one of your goals, if not getting right out of camp next year, and that's not out of the question, but the Team Canada situation this year, so unfortunate. And we know that you had COVID. You're open about that. You said you had some side effects afterwards. Are you all healed up? How is your health doing?
Yeah, I'm obviously 100% now. Yeah, I think it took me a couple months though, for sure. Definitely never felt like that in my life before. But I think kind of the post-COVID effects, it just took me a little bit to kind of get back to 100%. And nothing I could really do about it, but just kept on working on it every day. So, yeah.
Yeah, well, we're glad to hear you're doing well now. And I mean, Ridly, you've become a quarantine king now. The amount we were talking off air, the amount of quarantine you've had to do. So what are you doing to keep yourself busy when you're quarantining? A lot of Call of Duty, a lot of Netflix. You got a lot of schoolwork you got to keep on. What's keeping you busy?
Yeah, well, definitely not schoolwork. I definitely cashed that a while ago. But when I was kind of quarantined hard there, I was playing video games, Call of Duty. We were playing quite a bit of that. Now it's pretty much poker and cards all day long, pretty much 8 hours to 10 hours a day. So yeah, playing with my team, which is pretty fun. It kind of time flies by, but definitely gets pretty boring and lonely sometimes.
So what's the setup? You're in a WHL bubble. Is there just kind of like one common room you guys are allowed to hang in?
Yeah, so I have four roommates and then kind of a common kitchen and coach living room sort of area, and I think you're allowed like 10 guys in a room or something, so everyone kind of comes over to my room and we'll play cards pretty much all day long, so it's pretty nice. Yeah.
Hey, that's awesome. Good way to get to know your teammates, playing poker with them. You can really get a handle on their personalities and everything, so that's great. Now, you said you're in the Regina bubble right now. You've been there for a while. Now, are you able to go through your kind of usual game day routines, or with the COVID protocols and everything that's going on, has that really been shaken up for you?
Yes and no. I think kind of at the start, you kind of had to adapt to being inside the bubble and kind of the different things. I think we're not allowed to be at the rink super early before games. I think it's maybe 2 hours before or something. So that was kind of the first thing. You kind of had to rush to tape your stick and warm up and everything before the game. But other than that, I think it's been fine. You know, you go to the rink for your morning skate and then have pregame, some meetings, and then I'm a pretty big nap guy. I'll nap to 2 hours and a half or something, and then it's pretty much you get up and you're ready to go. So but yeah, it's been pretty simple for me so far.
So you're more a nap during the day guy, because Jake told us he's in bed at 8:30 every night.
Yeah, I'm a pretty big nap guy during the day. I'll pass out for 3 hours on game day sometimes. Yeah.
Hey, as long as you're up when the puck drops, and clearly it's been producing for you. 23 points in 15 games, mix in 33 penalty minutes as well. We know what a bulk of those came from as well in the first game of the season. But how would you describe your game to somebody who hasn't watched yet? Would rambunctious be a good word?
Yeah, I think there's a couple words. I think another word probably be pretty competitive. But yeah, I try to kind of be a two-way centerman who's competitive and can provide offense for my team. So yeah.
Is there any NHL guy? Have I heard you say Nazem Kadri is the guy you model your game after?
Yeah, lots of people say that. I think I kind of like it. He's a pretty competitive guy. He's got lots of skills. So I think he's a pretty good guy to compare me for.
Yeah, I think people that have watched you play can definitely make those comparisons, and that seems to make sense. Now, you said you want to be a two-way offensive centerman, but like we talked about, you've got a bit of an edge to your game, just like Nazem Kadri. Now, where did you kind of get that edge? Is that something that your dad kind of passed along, or as you grew up, you kind of grew that fire a little bit more? Were you always like that? Is it something new, or where does that edge come from?
Yeah, I think it kind of always was in me. I think growing up, I was always kind of pretty competitive guy. I think when it kind of sparked quite a bit was when I was 16, my first year junior. I think obviously wasn't having like all the opportunity or had the puck a lot. So I tried to, you know, just lay ahead or lay the body or try to piss off guys or do whatever I could do to make a difference in the hockey game. Really was what I was trying to do. So I think that was that year kind of came in my game the most.
What'd that guy in Winnipeg do for you to put his stick in the 30th row?
That's actually a good buddy of mine. We were laughing about that after the game. I didn't even know what I was really doing. I thought I'd just lift his stick to piss him off a little bit. And apparently he wasn't holding on to his stick very well. So I went about 30 feet in the air.
Yeah, his fault, not yours, right?
Yeah, it's a lesson. hang on to the stick, man.
It's on your stick, yeah.
So what's the motivation if you're not able to get playoffs in this year? Is it just all about finishing first in the conference?
Yeah, pretty much. I think we're up there right now, or second or first right now. But yeah, try to win as much games as you can, I guess, until you never know when your last game's going to be right now due to the circumstances. So obviously try to get a Eastern Conference banner, I guess.
And like you're gaining positive momentum, like sure, maybe there's not that big trophy dangling in you, the Mem Cup isn't an option, unfortunately, but it's still great development. And as you're working through this year and going into the off season, what are some things you're trying to work on, Ridly, to get ready for next season?
Yeah, obviously whenever you step on the ice, you try to get better and you try to build your game. I guess we have 6 games left now, so I'll go through these 6 games and then pretty much hit the off season running and try to build my body and gain some weight. I think that's kind of the number one thing I'm going to be trying to work on, is getting my weight up and build my body. So, yeah.
Has it been discussed with the Sens organization that once you're done in Brandon, you're not going to be coming back to Belleville to finish out?
I'm not sure yet. I think we don't know yet if I have to quarantine or what the deal is going to be. So I'll probably find out in the next couple of weeks for sure.
Still great to get a taste though this season. That's awesome. And like I said at the start, your dad's been in hockey for, I'm sure, as long as you've been alive, and being a scout with Philadelphia, you have any good interactions? I know there's been some sick Flyers teams in the mix there. Have you had any good interactions with any of the guys that have come up through that system?
A little bit, yes and no. I think obviously when I was a kid, I was going to games, going to Calgary games and Edmonton games, and I'd always get kind of autographs and blah, blah, blah. But one of the guys I connected with a little bit was Nolan Patrick, who was – he was at my first camp in Brandon, and I sat beside him, stallmates. I'll kind of remember that. And then I kind of chit-chat with him in the summer this year, joking around and laughing. But he was probably the only guy, and yeah.
Who'd you cheer for growing up? Let's take the Flyers out of the mix in case that was an easy answer. But did you have a favorite team when you were growing up?
Other than the Flyers, I don't even know. I don't even know what I would say. My family bleeds orange, so
yeah, fair.
Well, what about, I'll give you a more open-ended question then. Who were the guys you watched in the NHL that you really idolized growing up? Doesn't matter what team. Doesn't have to be similar to your game or anything. Just who were you a fan of growing up?
It's going
to
be Eric Lindros, easy, Claude Giroux, Scott Laughton probably.
Yeah, the only team I watched when I was growing up was the Flyers. So I guess when I was really young, I think Mike Richards, who I've actually been compared to a little bit as well. I think some guys say I play like him a little bit too. Him and then kind of in the last 5 or 6 years, I like watching Drew and kind of how he has the skill and competitiveness as well.
Good Ottawa boy, Claude Giroux.
Yeah, exactly.
So we're looking forward to getting you to Sens development camp whenever it could be, or back to the city. And at least you guys will be able to go out to the market or something once all this COVID's back, because that's the real kind of bummer of this season, especially with such a young team like Ottawa. You want the kids to get together and have a good time. So everyone's excited for you to get in the mix, Ridly, and enjoy the rest of your season. And Brandon, everyone's watching. We know Sens Prospects is up clipping all your games late, and everyone's really excited to watch you develop. And some people are saying you're the forgotten first-round pick just because they had two in the same draft. It's pretty rare you get three in the same draft, but man, it's been a treat watching you play, and it's always always puts a smirk on our face when you throw someone's stick up in the rafters. So keep that youthful exuberance, man. We love to see it. Really appreciate you taking some time with us today.
Yes, thank you. Thanks for having me, guys.